Lord, you are so good. Lord, you are kind. Lord, you are wonderful. My Lord, you are excellent. Excellent is your name. Oh yes, excellent is your power. Lord, you are wonderful. My Lord, you are excellent. Why don't we sing that song together and worship the Lord in the Spirit? Let's worship Him together. Lord, you are so good. Oh yes, Lord, you are kind. Lord, you are wonderful. My Lord, you are excellent. Oh yes, excellent is your name. Oh yes, excellent is your power. Lord, you are wonderful. My Lord, you are excellent. Excellent is your name. Oh yes, excellent is your power. Lord, you are wonderful. My Lord, you are excellent. I want us to be in the Spirit because the Lord is going to do something marvelous in your life. I know it very sure that the entrance of God's word, we always give light. Anywhere the word of the King is, there's authority there. Father, we thank you for this morning. Thank you for what you are doing in our life. Thank you for what you have already done. Take all the glory in the name of Jesus. As we look at the perfect law of liberty, Lord, today, give us liberty. Give us freedom. Every form of financial crisis, we overcome it today in the name of Jesus. He said to open their eyes, to turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, to grant them forgiveness of sin and inheritance among them that are sanctified by faith as in me. Lord, I pray today that every hearer of this word will become doer of your word and you will save them. Thank you, precious Father. In Jesus' name I have prayed. Amen. Today's Sunday, by the grace of God, we are looking at what I call overcoming financial crisis in the family. Amen. Your family is important to God. Your business is important to God. Your children is important to God. How do you overcome the financial crisis that is already in the world? The global world is experiencing serious trouble financially because of this COVID-19. But there's always a law of exemption. God will exempt you. For the Bible would make it clear that the salvation of the righteous is of the Lord. He will deliver them. Amen. I think some people have said, that was salvation in Psalm 37 verse 39. Does not mean to be saved or to be born again. It means the Lord will going to deliver the righteous again and again and again and again. So this financial crisis that hitting the world will not consume you in the name of Jesus. You will be exempted. He will save you. He will provide for you in the name of Jesus. Let's take our text from Luke chapter 5 from verses 1 to 7. Luke chapter 5. That's where our text will be taken. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake. But the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. Verse 3. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon, and prayed him that he thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Verse 4. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, launch out into the deep, and let down your net for a draught. Verse 5. And Simon answered and said unto him, Master, we have toiled all night, and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. Look at verse 6. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were on the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships, so that they began to sink. Now, then, when Peter saw this in verse 8, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man. So, the experience of Peter here is going to be our keynote. The Bible says he toiled all night and he caught nothing. All night. That means there was something hitting him and hitting his business. Whatever is happening to your business, whatever is happening to your life, whatever is happening to your finances, heaven will give you a way out. Jesus said, pull out your boat a little bit and let me use it for preaching the gospel. And Jesus stepped into it and preached to the multitude. After he finished preaching, he will never return your boat to you empty. Hallelujah. You know, the Peter and the rest of them were already washing their net. They were disappointed all through the night. All their technology failed. All that they have learned in the fishing industry over the years failed. Where and when fish should be at each time of the day, all those technology failed. Jesus said, "Can't get me your boat." After preaching, he said, "Launch out into the deep for a draught." Peter knew that that time of the day, fish will not be around that place. But Jesus has spoken. Amen. For the word of the Lord is powerful. And because Jesus has spoken, Peter said, because of thy word, I will let down the net. And you know the result? He had a very great catch. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So crisis, financial crisis, has roots. And we'll be able to trace the root. And like I said earlier on, one of the worst crises for the church today, for the body of Christ, for the people of God, is the financial crisis hitting the world through this COVID-19. Nations of the world have overshot their budget. They are spending what they don't even have. Hallelujah. Including our nation. Because COVID-19 took a lot from people. But I believe God that after you hear this message, your family will be saved in the name of Jesus. The first thing to overcome financial crisis is to identify the root cause. Amen. You must identify the root cause. Peter knew his own root cause. He said, "Depart from me, I am a sinful man." He knew he has not kept God's commandment. And the Bible says, those who keep God's commandment will not feel any evil thing. That's what the Bible says. Now, Peter knew he has not kept his commandment. So when the crisis came, he hit him up. The crisis hit his business so much that he was already washing their neck, going home disappointed. Now, so we must trace, number one, the root cause. Hallelujah. The root cause. Global crisis, as we are having it now, through this COVID-19, has happened before. In Genesis chapter 42, now start from chapter 41, you see, the king of Egypt had a dream, and nobody could interpret the dream for him. The dream will have serious financial implications on the nation of Egypt at the time of Joseph. So, and God revealed something to the king. He couldn't understand. All his magicians could not understand. They couldn't know how to diagnose and how to solve the problem. So they called for Joseph. Hallelujah. And when Joseph came, you know, if you go to chapter 42, he was able to give them the download of the solution. Praise God. Now, but how does it affect the children of God? In Genesis 42, let me quickly read for you verses 1 and 2. How does it affect the children of God? It was coming to the world, but how they escape? And when Jacob saw that there was corn in Egypt, Jacob said unto his son, "Why do ye look one upon another?" And he said, "Behold, I have heard that there is corn in Egypt. Get you down either, and buy us from thence, that we may live and not die." That's a word from the experience of Jacob. He saw that the pandemic is ravaging the land. The trouble is globally. The trouble has gone beyond Egypt. No food anywhere. The famine is biting hard. He said, "Go to Egypt, for I heard that there's corn there, and buy us so I will not die." Now look at verse 3. And Joseph's 10 brethren went down to buy corn in Egypt because they want to come out, they want a way out of this trouble that's already hidden the land. So I'm saying the global crisis can be a reason for financial crisis. The global crisis like this COVID-19 is a global phenomenon. It's a problem the world is still battling with. It can be the reason why your finances may not flow the way it should flow. Number two, we have what we call national crisis. It may have great effect on the household income.
In that Luke chapter 5 that we read, you see, Peter said, we have toiled all night and we caught nothing. Anything could have happened. Just like it is today. No, for the past 8-9 weeks, people can't even go out. Talk of making money. They were spending the one they had. And after you spending the one you have, what next? Children must eat. House rent must be paid. Hallelujah. And as it affects the hidden, it also affects the church. Because we are all living in the same society. But how will you escape? Or how shall we escape? What will happen now, apart from global crisis, it has become national crisis. Amen. The nations, our nation is groaning under the burden of COVID-19. Amen. Spending the money we do not have. And I pray today, the wisdom to manage it and to escape, like God gave to Peter, he will give to you in the name of Jesus. Number three is the economy meltdown. Hallelujah. It will have direct impact on the family. Hallelujah. When there's no, like Nigeria, you say, we call it mono economy. We only depend on oil. When the oil crashed, the oil price crashed, what do we have to sell again? Nothing more. Hallelujah. So you find out that our GDP will come down. Huh? Find out that as it happens globally, it happens nationally, it happens. Inflation rate will be high. Hallelujah. Interest rate will be high. Nobody is doing any business. No money to do it. Even if you want to do it, you cannot go out. Amen. How much will you do online? How many people are online here? I am saying all these have family impact. It has impact on every individual. The father, the mother, the children. The children are not going to school because of COVID-19. Look at me here. They are to flee. That what God put is in my heart. That after this today's telecast and prayer, God will show you the way out. In the name of Jesus. He showed Joseph in Egypt the way out of the famine. And so his family back home, Jacob and his family escaped because they have a place to go where they can buy corn for their family so they won't die with the famine. Before Jacob would say that means a lot of women have died from the famine. Around there, they saw it. But God, in his infinite mercy, positioned Joseph in Egypt. Put him in the place of honor, put him in the place of provision. So when his family came, hallelujah, eventually, when Jacob arrived in Egypt, he put them in the land of Goshen, where he said, stay near me where I'll be taking care of you and nursing you, for there are still yet many years to go. Now, nobody knows how long this COVID-19 will last. Some people are predicting 2021. Some say 2022. A lot of, in fact, some people said that the world may never be the same again. Economically, the world may never be the same again because it is going to cause a kind of crisis in world economy that it will, look at the prediction of United Nations. They are predicting 4 billion people to be affected globally through this COVID-19. That is, the children that will not have food to eat, the number has increased. Amen. I was doing study and I saw that they already predicted that malnutrition will increase because of this terrible pandemic around the world. But I believe God that God will save you. I believe God that God will save your family. I believe God that God will save your children. I believe God that God will save our nation. I believe God that God will save our land. The way God saved Jacob and his family, he will save you in the name of Jesus. Now, so economic that can be a problem, can be a reason why things are not going to be the same financially. Number four, satanic attack on the family can bring financial crisis. Amen. Peter couldn't explain in the same river or the same boat, the same net, the same in Peter couldn't catch anything throughout the night. There are mysteries that you can't explain. Financial crisis can be mysterious. It can be a situation where work, no pay. You do everything, it's like motion without movement. You try everything possible, everything suggested in books, but it didn't work because there's a satanic attack. Amen. You have tried everything. You tried this business. You tried that business. You tried this one. Some people will try so many things. Nothing is working because there is a satanic attack. I've discovered it. Now, when Satan is attacking a family, or attacking a man, or attacking a nation, or attacking a community, everything that's supposed to produce, not produce. The ground refuses to produce. The business will not produce. The projection, business projection will fail. You projected that if I had 2 + 2, I would get 4. You are getting 2. Amen. What do you do? All projection fail. Every effort you are making is not becoming, is not producing fruit. When it happens like that, there's a satanic undertone. Satan is attacking the family. And I believe God today, in the name that's above every name, every satanic attack on your life is caused in the name of Jesus. God has the power to deliver your family from financial crisis and from satanic attack. You have made every effort. Look, listen to me. It's not that you are lazy, but it's an attack. It's not that you're not working, but it's an attack. It's not that you're not, it's not that you're not trying. Nobody says you are not doing anything. Leave too early in the morning, come back late in the night, and yet nothing to show. It's an attack. Even before COVID-19 came, hallelujah, a lot of people are struggling. You see them struggle and struggle and struggle and struggle. Yet nothing, early to leave, late to come. And yet, no food on the table because there is a satanic attack. A family came to me and were just talking and they were expressing their displeasure at what they are going through. The husband is trying, the wife is trying, every effort they made, not producing anything. Why? Because I said, because there is a satanic attack. When my enemies shall come like a flood, sometimes they come like a flood. The Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against them. So I want to believe God with you today that whatever be the satanic attack on your life, on your finances, on your marriage, on your business, today I command it to enter the ground in the name of Jesus. What about when you get the goods and credit and nobody's buying? You collected on credit. I will return the money in 2 weeks' time. 3 weeks you have not sold a penny. That's a satanic attack. Not that you are not smart. Not that you are not good. Now you don't know what you are doing. You know everything that the nitty gritty of that business, but yet the business refuses to move because there's a satanic attack. Like, listen to me. Peter recognized that something went wrong. The same Peter in that fishing industry. Oh yes, he must succeed. But when all your must succeed became no success, it's a sign that Satan is at work somewhere. And I believe today you will overcome it in the name of Jesus. In 2 Kings chapter 4, the story of a man who died, leaving death behind. Now there cried a certain woman of the wives of the sons of the prophet unto Elisha, saying, thy servant, my husband, is dead. And thou knowest that thy servant did fear the Lord. And the creditor is come to take unto him my 2 sons to be bond men. Hallelujah. My husband, your servant, the servant of the prophet, one of the sons of the prophet, and the servant of God is dead. Nobody knew what killed him. It might be depression from the financial crisis. No, the woman said, but the creditors. That means he too went out of his way to borrow money to sustain his family or sustain his business, and he couldn't pay and he died. The creditors wanted their money by all means. What would they do? They came for the 2 children. Hallelujah. They come for the children to go and serve for the death of their father. Amen. But look at me here. The woman was wise enough to run to the man of God. He said, your servant is dead. This is what is befalling us. And Elisha said, verse 2, Elisha said unto her, what shall I do for thee? Tell me, what hast thou in the house? And she said, thy handmaid has not anything in the house save a pot of oil. Oh my goodness. Look at me here. They have something. They have a pot of oil. Hallelujah. And I will read the scripture for you now. That there's nobody that has nothing. Hallelujah. Look at Matthew chapter 25. From verse 14. I like that scripture. Matthew 25. We read from verse 14. Thank you, Jesus. For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who call his own servant and deliver unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to everyone according to his several ability, and straightway took his journey. Then he that had received 5 talents went and traded with them and made them other 5 talents. He gave them according to their several ability. Amen. That means there's no one of us that is left with nothing. You have something. Amen. God made me to understand that he has given everyone according to his several ability to survive in time of economic meltdown, to survive in time of famine, to survive in time of COVID-19, to survive in time of pandemic that may be ravaging the world. He already knew it. He saw it ahead and he has made provision. Praise God. He has made provision for you and for your family. Only it's waiting for your discovery. Amen. Because discovery will lead to recovery. Until you discover who you are in Christ, until you discover your identity, until you discover what God has made available for you, to survive in crisis might be difficult. And this, the message, he gave some 10 talents, some 5, some 2. He gave one of them 1 at the return of the man to ask them to come and give account. One of them that had 10 has gained 10. The one that has 5 has gained 5. The one that had 2 has gained 2. The one that has 1 gained nothing. Look at me. Until you identify your area of strength, you may end up in the hand of the wicked. You must identify your area of strength. What do you have? What talent have you? What has God given to you? Amen. I remember so many years back, the Lord told me to begin to pray for women and men who have infertility problem. I never knew anybody can do that. I was just doing my pastoral work, come minister to them. But to pray for somebody asking for baby, I don't know. He said, that's what you'll be doing. So I began to ask God questions, and that's why I started. Hallelujah. Now look at me here. And this ministry to waiting mothers has gone around the world today. I didn't know I have it. I have the grace and the ability. I didn't know that my faith will carry a family looking for babies and pray with them, and they will have. I never knew. God knew he has put that ability inside me. Hallelujah. He knew I had the several ability, like somebody that was given 10 talents. I didn't know. Now listen to me. Whatever you suffer is what you are called to offer. Amen. Anything you suffer here, that's what you are called to offer. So that's how I started praying for them from nation to nation. Now there was even a time the first time I went to Abuja, Federal Capital Territory in Nigeria, for this Waiting Mothers Conference, I was going from church to so that they can help me. I went to a man's house who happened to be from my tribe. I explained to him what I'm here to do. He said, sir, go and do it. If you are successful, we will come and join you. We'll help you. Now, because it's not as popular as it is today. In the 90s when I started, it was not popular to gather waiting mother for what? So, as I left the man's house with the man who was my guide, as I hit the road, the Lord said to me, did you go to school? I said, yes, sir. So you can't go to Sheraton Hotel and book your hall, a board for your meeting. And you're looking for people to help you do that. Look at me here. Most times, what we have the ability to do, we are looking for others to do for us. God will never put a good thing on the surface of the earth It goes down, down the, it is man that will discover it. Man will go down to go and find gold, find bauxite. So the same thing are the treasures that God put in us. It includes something that will save us in time of crisis. The wisdom, the grace, the ability, the power, the prayer. Everything combined, you will survive crisis period. I am serious. I am not saying that God will not leave you alone. He said, I will not leave you comforted. I will come again. The Spirit of God is coming to remind you of everything that I have taught you. Listen, brethren, I am saying, even when this is crisis that comes from satanic attack, you have the grace and the wisdom to combat it and you will overcome it. Now, before we go on, I want to believe God that something good is happening. Now, another thing that can cause financial crisis is when you live above your income, okay? When you live above your income, you might have financial crisis. Living above your income will result into financial crisis. Look at me here. When your rent is above your income, if you're a pastor, your church rent, you're paying rent in the church, you're paying rent in the house. You're a family man, you're supposed to be living in a room, you're living in 5 rooms, you have a problem. When I got married, I had 2 3-rooms, December 1980, and it's 10 naira per room. That's what my capacity was. Amen. My salary was 70 naira. So if I remove 10 naira or 30 naira, I will still be able to feed. Now, on and on, the next house I took was 25 naira. Amen. A 2-bedroom flat. When your expenditure is above your income, you will have crisis. Crisis will come when your expenditure is above your income. Look at me here. And the next one is poor investment drive can lead to financial crisis. Poor investment drive. A lot of us doesn't have the mindset of any business. We just wake up in the morning, fold our hand, eat food and go and sleep. No, poor. When I just got married, I knew I needed more money to add it to what I was earning. I went a bush path near my house and I saw an old man farming. How are you, sir? I greeted him. I said, I want to farm. The man looked at me and said, I like away. And I said, I like away. How will you farm? I said, no, I grew up in the farm. My father was a farmer all through his life. They now pointed the sign and said, go and be farming there. It pointed to a place. And I started farming there for almost 8-9 years. Look at me here. I even have to bring other people who also are interested. And so I was able to raise enough food stuff for my family. Now, it's not so anymore today. Everybody wants a white collar job. When you have poor investment drive, you will have financial crisis. Number seven, all spending and no saving will drive you into financial crisis. All spending and no saving. You're just spending everything. You have problem. The moment you are just spending everything that comes to your hand without any legitimate income, without streams of income. Hallelujah. There's some people, they have streams of income from 3, 4, 5 sources. They can spend their money because another one is coming. But you that has only one source, no any other source. If you spend anyhow, you will live anyhow. You must not spend all without thinking of tomorrow. Now, look at me here. You have to find a way of generating financial supply for your family. There must be a way of generating financial supply, either buying and selling, either trading and trading, either export or import. Or you go and learn a trade. I'll tell you some people, I said, you better learn something because services is what produces income. If you are not offering service to anybody, nobody will pay you. Oh yes, you must be able to do something that others cannot do for themselves, and then they will pay you. But when you have nothing, you cannot do anything with your hand, you cannot do anything with your heart, you cannot do anything with your mind, you remain financial problem. Look at me here. You need to also find out what has God said about money. There are people think that to have money is to be a sinner. No, that's not true. You have to find out what God has said about money. Let's look at Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 12. Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 12. For wisdom is a defense, and money is a defense. But the excellency of knowledge is that wisdom gives life to them that have it. Look at it. Wisdom is a defense. Money is also a defense. That may God want you to have money. Chapter 10 of Ecclesiastes, chapter 10, verse 19. Hallelujah. Look at what he's saying about money. You need to know it. A feast is made for laughter, and wine maketh merry, but money answereth all things. Amen. Look at it. Money answereth all things. Money will give you a better accommodation. Hallelujah. If money can prolong your days, money will put good food on your table. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now, if you look at Acts chapter 4, 36 to 37, what has God said about money? Thank you, Jesus. Acts 4, 36 to 37. Thank you, Jesus. And Joseph, who by the apostle was named Barnabas, which is being interpreted the son of consolation, a Levite, and of the country of Cyprus, having land, sold it, and brought the money, and laid it at the apostles' feet. So they had money. If you look at chapter 6 of Acts of the Apostles, you see they began to have crisis. But number of people that were eating multiplied. Number of people who have no job, widows, orphans, and multiplying. So the church was having a problem. So somebody has to go and sell his land and brought the money. Amen. But there could be a better way of doing that. If you have, you are bringing, I am bringing, the family will be better for it. Now, in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, chapter 8, verse 9, what has God said about money? Chapter 8, verse number 9. For ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be rich. I mean, God wants you to be rich. He wants you to have enough and be able to give to others. Hallelujah. You have more than enough. You can extend the hand of fellowship to your neighbor, to your friend, to your brothers. Hallelujah. Now, if you look at Philippians chapter 4, from verse 10. Philippians chapter 4, from verse 10, as we're rounding up. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. But I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at last your care of me has flourished again. Wherein you were also careful, but ye lack opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want. I have learned in whatever state I am, thereby to be content. I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things, I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. Notwithstanding, you have well done that ye did communicate with my affliction. Now, you feel know that at the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from myself, to no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving, but ye only. Verse 16. For even in Thessalonica, ye sent once and again unto my necessity. Now, not because I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account. But I have all and abound. I am full, having received of Epaphroditus, the thing which was sent from you, an odor of a sweet smell, a sacrifice acceptable, well pleasing to God. But my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. I pray for you today, you have more than enough to be able to take care of your children and take care of your family and take care of the church of the living God. Before I round up, I was in a meeting where a pastor's car was said to have been stolen, and so many pastors, almost 80 of us, were praying for the man. Oh Lord, let him recover the car. I said, no. I opened my eyes. I said, oh God, how did you get here? He said, somebody came and dropped me. I said, okay. Now, I have two. I'll give you one. Tell them to stop the prayer and do something else. Amen. Hallelujah. I said, I have two. If you like it, I will give you one out of the two. So I'll take one. So when I told the great man of God that was leading prayer, I said, somebody just gave me another one here. I prefer that. That one is better than wasting our time praying on the car that has gone. I said, so on Wednesday of that following, we came to my office and I asked him, get paper, paper, and he took it away and joined it up to the family. God will make you a man like that, that will be able to, even during this COVID-19, be able to help others who are in need. But let me say before I go, financial crisis is normal in our world. I told some people, I said, nobody know after COVID-19, nobody know which one is coming again. You better start serving God now and keeping his commandment. For the Bible says, anyone that keeps the commandment will not feel any evil thing. You better start now. You better start observing all of these things that have been enumerated. You better start preparing for tomorrow, because nobody knows what tomorrow will bring about. Before I pray with you, brethren, listen. God is on your side. And if God be for us, who can be against you? I am very confident that whatever be the global and financial crisis, you and me will escape it. Can we pray together? Can you lift your two hands and say, Lord Jesus, help me. Wherever I've been missing it, Lord, give me the wisdom. Give me the understanding. Give me the grace. Step into my matter like you did for Peter. Step into my financial situation. I am in crisis. I don't know what to do again. Oh Lord, help me. Pray that prayer for yourself. I am in financial dilemma. I don't know what to do again. Oh Lord, help me. Oh Lord, help me. Open my eyes. Let me be able to find out what I have that I've not been making use of. That woman said, Elisha said, what do you have? He said, I have a bottle of oil in there. That is enough. That oil was there, and the husband still died in debt. Go and borrow so many vessels. And then told her what to do. He said, go and sell it and pay your debt and leave up the rest. That means there's something in your heart. There's something in your heart. There's something in your life God gave you. Lord, open my eyes to see it, so I can begin to explore it from today, to come out of the global financial crisis or national or family financial crisis, that will exempt me, because I already know what to do. Thank you, precious Father. In Jesus' name I have prayed. Look at me here. It's not a complainant that will be justified, but the person who knows what to do. Knowing what to do will help you in the time of financial crisis. Knowing exactly what to do. The Lord will teach you what to do. As we review this message again and again, this wisdom of God, there's this wisdom of God that will come upon you to show you what to do, what talent you have, what grace you have, what ability God has given to you, that can put to work now, and you believe in as king, even in the midst of this pandemic. Till I see you again, the Lord bless you.